We're the only type of organization in the world that understands that great things can happen when no one's in charge.
Remember the 70s and 80s?
I like to use three letters to describe this period, BTI, before the internet. The world was literally a world of stovepipes of information, all determined by what system you happened to be on and which system you made a phone call to in order to use the computer.
Large computer companies figured out how to connect their computers together, but these were all separate systems, and companies like IBM, Apollo, and Digital Equipment Corporation liked it that way.
They viewed these proprietary networks as a competitive advantage, because they figured if they could just keep people all wrapped into one network, then people would have to buy their equipment.
At about that time, the National Science Foundation issued a call for proposals to upgrade the overloaded NSFNET, which connected research institutions across the country.
So our proposal from the University of Michigan was a proposal to build the first large-scale internet.
An internet that would be open and not controlled by any one company, provider, or government.
We heard informally through the grapevine that it was likely we were going to win. And of course, John Armstrong, who was our partner at IBM, he was the head of IBM research at the time, when I called him to tell him that we were going to win this, he said, are you sure this is a win? Because of course we knew that we faced this enormous challenge. But we were young and aggressive and optimistic.
And they labored for many months, sometimes around the clock, with a growing staff in cramped quarters, racing to meet the NSF's deadline. And they were ready to go a month early, in July 1988.
We turned this network on. The network that it replaced was built on 56 kilobit communication lines. Think about that for a moment. 56 kilobits as the main network for all of the science in the United States. It was saturated. It wasn't performing well. For that reason, it was overloaded. The network we turned on was 1.5 megabits, 1.5 million bits per second, so big step up. Rather than thousands of computers connected to the network, we were starting to have hundreds of thousands of computers connected to the network. And furthermore, the internet is an intranet, right? It connects a bunch of different networks together. And so we had to cope with more and more networks being attached to the network backbone that NSFNet was. We had ambitions for what it would mean for the future of the world by the time we were a year or so into this effort. And we didn't want to fail, because we knew if we couldn't meet the challenge, then all the people out there who wanted to go back to the old way of stovepipes of information, where everybody gets their own little nickel from every time they access it, would say, I told you so. We knew this thing wouldn't work. And we need you to go back to the good old safe way of doing networking. None of this new NSF stuff, you know. Scientists don't really know how to do networking. It's us telecommunication companies and us computing companies that know how to do networking. But we kept it going. And at the end, we had millions of people on the network and millions of computers on the network, and people could no longer say, oh, this won't work, because it was clear that it worked.